All right, so let's start. Okay. Good morning, everyone. Today, the session is the SMP development on ARM boards. So let me introduce myself. I'm Satish. I work for KVM Networks, part of Monta Vista Group. So today, I'm just trying to give one of the board bring-up series. Actually, it is captured part of the board bring-up series. One of that is SMP controller. So part of this, I'm trying to capture a set of things called that introduction to the SMP functionality and the SMP functions call flow and the debugging SMP call flow and the usage where actually we are going to use this. So let me give the basic introduction of this board bring-up. Why I mentioned that board bring-up is if any board, specific to ARM board, if we want to make any board up, so there are a set of controllers that we have to make sure that those things should be really up. That means, you know, when you say board bring up, there are two areas. One is the early board bring up, and second one is the secondary board bring up. So part of the early board bring up, we actually take care of, you know, starting from the .dts file, we'll take the interrupt controller, we'll take the UART files, we'll take the timers, clocks, SMP, pin control, GPIO, early print key support. So these eight are the remaining basic controllers that we have to make sure in an early board bring-up series. So as a part of SOC vendor, any person will take care of these eight controllers. After that, they'll go into the second session of or the secondary board bring-up. You call as I2CR, SPI, PCIe, SATA, USB, and all. These are part of secondary board bring-up. So part of this, the SMP, which is comes under the early board bring-up. So one of the functionality of that. So I'm trying to find out that. So one more thing here, when we call about this board bring up series, there are two things. When we are talking about the SMP, the most people think that the issues comes with respect to this is the coherency issues. So the coherency issues are basically comes once the entire system is up and we are processing set of threads or the process to the corresponding cores, right? So the intention is, before you are getting that system, how you are making the system up with respect to SMP is the point here, right? So with that, let's get into the basic functionality of SMP. So it's a symmetric multiprocessing. So it means that you have, in a system, you have multiple cores of the same type, right? So it's a software architecture. It is defining that dynamically determines the roles of individual cores, and each core in the cluster has the same view of memory and of the shared hardware. So any application or process or task can run any core, and the operating system scheduler can dynamically migrate tasks between the cores to achieve the optimal system load. This is where actually we define IRQ balance or the load balancer defined by the scheduler. Because when we talk about in a single core coming from the single core or SMP, there we mention that there is a per CPU IRQ and there's a local timer for each CPU. So these two, IRQ and the timer, are the basic two things to make sure that the second core should be up, right? Because once the system is completely up, we have to make sure that these two things should be up. Otherwise, the scheduler won't tick that particular SMP core. So that is one thing that the understanding of this slide is, you know, take care of the minimal controller support to each SMP. That's where actually it will take care of dynamically determining the number of process or the threads coming from the scheduler, okay? So now, if you take this slide, It is basically taking care of the basic SMP functions call flow, starting from the image decompression. Anyway, this I take from the ARM community only. So if we see this, starting from the kernel zimage decompression, which starts from the compressor slash head.s, starting from that, we have the initializing the main memory, cache, and MMU specific to CPU 0, and then getting into the start kernel. So here, the one more thing is here, we are going through the core kernel code, we are going to the platform dependent code, we are going to the architecture code. That means arc arm kernel setup.c, I can say that, which is very specific to the ARM architecture. When I say that plot smp.c, it is specific to the board related files, right? So when I say that start underscore kernel, it is part of the pure platform independent. So the start kernel will be common to anyone. It can be ARM architecture, it can be x86, or it can be PowerPC. So holding that point, so initialize the main memory, cache, and MMU specific to CPU 0, because the thing is, when you start the processor, the first thing is the CPU 0, or the boot CPU called as. Maybe it can be CPU 0, or it can be CPU 1. But most probably, in the ARM boards, the boot process will be start from the CPU 0 only. So based on that, this diagram says that initialize the main memory cache and memory usage to CPU 0 and then getting into the start kernel, which is part of platform independent code. From there, we are giving one process called kernel init, part of process 0. And then initialize the SMP environment and boot all the secondary CPUs and wait for this IRQ event, right? So from here, so this is the basic diagram. We are trying to capture it. So we will get inside what actually it is doing inside. So we will try to capture all the functions which is trying to hit. When we say that the platform independent core or architecture dependent code or the kernel specific code, we'll see that what are all the functions it is going to hit for part of this. So for this, I have used one of the board called JetBoard, part of Xilinx ZC702, using ARM Cortex A9 dual core, and a kernel version, bit pretty old I have used actually, which I have done it for the part of my, you know, office, part of the office I have done this. So SMP call flow involves these core kernel functions, called as platform independent code and the architecture dependent code and the board SMP code. Why I have mentioned that board SMP code is, if any board vendor wants to design or wants to support the SMP, they should maintain that plot SMP.c because that will take care of the actual design of SMP. So what actually that plot SMP will be taking care is, we'll discuss that. And see, here, the SMP functions identification. So identification will be done through the register called the MPIDR, which is called as the multiprocessor affinity register, which is the code is running on CPU 0 or CPU 1 is identified by reading the coprocessor CP15, we can say that. So from that, the primary core finishes the actual booting and it will provides the, and while the secondary core waits in the secondary bootloader for a jumping address, so the jump address we should provide in the plot SMP.c. From that jump address, it will get into the actual secondary core. That we will see that in the next slides. So coming to the designing flow, these are the specific to the ARM code, which is talking about SMP init CPUs, SMP prepare CPUs, SMP secondary init, and the boot secondary. So these four functions are actually defines, which are all part of plot SMP.c code only. So that is why this plot SMP is the main function or the main file which designs actual SMP of each board, right? So part of this SMP init CPUs, prepare CPUs, the intention of this is the SMP init CPUs is actually called in the early boot process, part of the setup architecture, and it will be called set of possible CPUs using the CPU underscore possible functionality. And then prepare CPUs, which takes off the coherency. So because when you talk about the coherency, then there is multiple cores, right? Coherency is actually taking care of L1 data cache interconnection between the two cores, right? So that will be done by the Snoop control unit. Anyway, that we will discuss in the end, how that Snoop control unit uses and what is the protocol it is using to make sure that the coherence will be worked between the different cores. So right, SMB, so here I have to make sure in, that coherency should be enabled there, and then initializes the CPU possible map and prepare the resources. It can be power, RAM, clock, whatever. So called early during the boot process. This is part of, again, setup architecture. And then SMP secondary init, it will be used to perform the platform specific initialization of the specified CPU, and it will be called from the secondary start kernel on the CPU. And then last one is the boot secondary, SMP boot secondary. It actually boots a secondary CPU identified by the CPU number given in a parameter, and then call from CPU up on the booting CPU. So this is where we have seen actually in the diagram, that CPU up function. So if you see that there is a CPU underscore up of CPU. I don't know if it will work for this or not. So there, below that IRQ, there is CPU underscore CPU where I'm getting the secondary CPUs options there. I'm starting all the secondary CPUs from there now. Yeah, so this is all I've taken from the elinux.org, which is already designed by the, I think, Thomas from Free Electrons. So now, the actual functions call flow. So this is the actual one that which will be used for any debugging of SMP operations, or we can understand that what are all the functions it is hitting, starting from the start kernel. When we talk about in the diagram that image decompression, right? Part of that image decompression, what are all the files it is hitting till it reaches to number of CPUs present on the board. Till that level, what are all the functions it is going to hit is starting from start kernel, tick init, boot CPU init. So one more thing is the page address in it. So we can, I mean, we can understand the function names by seeing that. But yeah, I have mentioned that one is the bold one, other one is the not bold one. So the bold one is specific to the platform dependent code, and not bold is the platform independent code. That means when we say SMP call flow, it will be goes through both architecture dependent code and the architecture independent code. That is the main point of adding this slide, right? So you can see that rcom kernel setup.c, part of that setup underscore arc is the function that I'm trying to call. And then SMP init CPUs and rcom kernel. Anyway, these are the things that we can just have a look of that. Init IRQ, trap init, time init, memory init. So that the thing is, when that SMP core is getting ready, the basic framework provided by the architecture code is giving a set of functionalities. From there, the board SMP code is giving a set of support. With that, kernel facilities are actually giving the entire stuff. So that those SMP cores are getting everything from all these areas, architecture code, platform code, and the platform independent code, so that it is getting into the actual SMP secondary init, right? So these are the functions, let's say here also. So rcom mac jinkplat smp.c. Here I'm saying that jink SMP prepare CPUs, because I have captured this part of my JetBoard where it is going to the plat smp.c of mac-jink, right? So part of that, jink SMP prepare CPUs. That is the one we can check it out. And jink CPN start. So this jink secondary init. So these functions are common for any plat smp.c specific to the board. If you go to the Qualcomm board or you go to the TA board, it's part of the, either maybe it can be OMAP or it can be MSM series of that name, right? So here you can see that secondary start kernel is one of the functions called from rcom kernel smp.c. And then jink secondary init, but anyway, I will try to capture it in a more formatted way. So here, there are total 39 functions we captured here. And now, we can try to see that how we have actually applied that. Same, I mean, we have mentioned that set of functions in a regular way. I mean, I have given a set of numbers. But once we create a patch and we apply that on the board, let's see that how it actually captures that. Because finally, the system, what it is saying, so that if you see that, we can understand that actually for the SMP call flow, what actually it is trying to hit. So that we will come to know. I'm sorry, actually, I have given my name instead of the debugging. That actually I have done it for my purpose. But yes, you can just remove that name. But you think that when you say starting application, nothing but image decompression. Starting from the image decompression, we can see that the first function it is calling as kernel init entry. So when we are writing a patch, I didn't even know that where it is going to hit. It can be 1, 2, 3, or it can be 3, 2, 1. I really don't know the sequence. But yes, we are telling that I have taken one sequence and I'm putting that patch into the kernel when I'm starting that board. So I'm capturing this in this sequence. So this is the actual functions that are actually hitting it, right? So kernel init entry is the first function. After that, kernel tick init is the second one. And then it is giving me the CPU ID. What is the CPU? So by the time the ID number is CPU 0. And then memory subsystem. So these are all for the CPU 0 functionality. Let's see where it is actually going to the second CPU also. So I can see that 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5. My 6 is missed somewhere. So 6 will be coming in the next level. So CPU initialization function, and then CPU init for secondary CPU. So see that CPU init is called for the function CPU 0. And the same function called for the secondary CPUs also. That is the intention. 7 and 29 came in one after the other. That means that same function called for both CPU 0 and CPU 1. So that in that way, we can identify even here, captured, let's say that, see, the 29th function name, rcom kernel setup.c CPU underscore, it's same as function number 7. That means this function is used for CPU 0 and for both CPU 1 also. That is where we can see that here, function 7 and the function 29 are being called one after the other. And then machine name is fine. So parse kernel arguments and then parse earlier arguments and then CPU map function 6. So we can identify that where here the function call flow starting from there. And we can see that here earlier I have given only the function names, but here I mentioned that what actually it is doing, what each function is actually being supposed to do. So you can take that set processor affinity and then free memory page in all zones. and then slab allocation, and then schedule init for CPU 0, and then init interrupt table, GIC traps. So these are all things part of that. And then we can see that soft IRQ init, and then system timer init, and then console init, and speed of the CPU clock, and speed of the secondary CPU clock also. This is where, again, I have called twice the same function. And then rootfs init, and init process creation. So the thing is here, we can take each function, and we can try to understand what actually that function is doing internally. But yeah, that will be, again, a separate process. But yes, we are trying to hit the function. So at the end, if we want to really understand how that SMP, or if there is any issue with the SMP, we can identify that one of these functions are missing, or there may be an issue part of these functions. So that's where it can be used for the debugging purpose, right? So that is the intention of capturing these functions also. So move data to all CPUs, and move and store data, and then start prepare CPUs, and then initialize SCU. That's where this initialize SCU is also part of plot SMP function only, plot SMP.c file only. That's where part of boot secondary, part of that we mentioned that initialize SCU, part of that SCU peripheral base. There's a one address we have to provide there. That's where that SCU should be initialized, part of our ARM core. And then allocate initial page tables, and then create new ideal process for each CPU 1 or 2, and boot every offline CPU, and then boot the secondary CPU. And if you can see here, yeah. So official start of the secondary CPUs, official start of the kernel for secondary CPUs, and then, yeah. So this is the actual one. You can see that display number of CPUs, and then total of 2 processes activated. So now, the intention of this one is, in a regular format, we can see that with a maximum 10 functions, we can see that the initialization of these, the final one, what I have captured here. Yeah. So SMP total of number of processes activated in a regular decompression, we can see that within of maximum in 10 functions, right? Virtual memory layout, after that we can see this. So, but to hit this guy, we came into all these areas. I mean, like these all functions we have hit, and then we get into that area. So that's where we are trying to find out all the functions which are gone through to get into the complete SMP should be up. So I have added a set of more functions which will be used for the part of this allocate init page tables, part of RCS also added, root file system also. So with this, but anyway, this is the final one that where you can say that display number of CPUs. Part of the function 39, we can see that what that function 39 is. With that, yes, we can identify that number of processors activated. So part of this, we are identifying all the functions hitting through that, and we can come to know that the actual debugging, or you can say that if I want to have any problems with the SMP, part of board bring up series. I again mentioned that part of the board bring up series, we can easily understand that the functions that it is hitting, and if there is any issue or any issue comes part of kernel porting or board bring up, we can come to know that yes, this is this can be used as a reference for all the things that which we are going to miss actually. So this is, yeah. One more thing, I have removed this call schedule function number 23, because this schedule function is keep calling every time. So it won't make you to get inside. The next functions, it shouldn't be allowed. So that this part I have taken out, because it makes that completely, it puts in a loop actually, so that we shouldn't keep it there, because we don't really get that actual debugging purpose. So then, yeah. The final thing is identifying the SMP code flow, and if there is any number of clusters means, you know, combination of cores when you have, and there will be a lot of issues comes actually. See, the intention of doing this SMP specifically is when I work for Cisco, I have an issue actually. When we have a lot of clusters, they have a problem with identifying the secondary CPUs. I mean, like whatever the kernel we are giving to them, with that, the board is fine. But when they come up with their own boards, it starts failing there. So that's where, like, we find out, like, why that issue is coming. So from there, like, I have prepared this, like, it will be useful for them. And so that for us also, when there is any, it can be 2 cores or it can be 32 cores. So we can easily identify that from where it is actually getting to be hitted or where it is going to be missed, right? So the best thing is they says that CP underscore up function will provide you the IRQ event so that you are getting into the other next SMP cores based on the jump address. Yeah, that is one thing. Yeah, so part of that, so the basic usage is, yes, when there is a porting issues comes and when there is a board bring up issues comes. And the other thing is, I've added set of things, part of these clocks, GPIO, UART also, part of this embedded Linux community, which is, I mentioned earlier, you know, for the people who are not okay. So for any board bring up, right, I'm talking about different controllers, the basic controllers, part of clocks, timers, interrupt controllers, and GPIO, pin control, everything. I mean, there are a set of 8 controllers. So I tried to identify the basic things and captured the same way for the clocks, GPIO, UART, debug flow, part of the JetBoard only. And I've added that in that particular, the link which I've added. So there also we can see that the same flow. So it can be easy for the people who really wants to work on the SOC vendors, right? I mean, like, let's say that I've been working with TA or part of Qualcomm. If we want to make any board bring up, so we can take this as a reference because it's a platform dependent code is very less and remaining things is architecture dependent code and the kernel dependent code, which is common to everyone. So remaining things, yes, we can identify through these functions like how we have captured. The same way I have captured for the clocks, GPIO also. Clocks, GPIO, UART also, and I've added there the patch which I took it. Even SMP also I've added the patch. So that will be more descriptive if we want to add more things. So yeah, that is the thing. Yeah, thank you. So one more thing I want to add here. So when we are using this SMP, right, the basic thing is the issue comes is the coherency issues, right? These coherence issues actually will be come up with a Snoop control unit. Basically, Snoop control unit will take care of the issues coming from one code to the other. So these things will be taken care with the help of a protocol called, you know, AMBA5. We can use AMBA5 IC protocol, or there is a one particular protocol, MOESI. MOESI. So there is a modified or outdated or the exclusive, shared, and invalid. So that SCU will take care between one core to the other core, whatever the thread is running. And if it wants to be shared between these two cores, it will be taken care. So it is actually, you know, there are two things. One is the software dependent stuff, and the other one is the hardware dependent cache coherency management. So basically, in the ARM boards, it will be done by the SCU, which is part of hardware coherency management, part of this MOESI protocol. There's nothing but it, just like, you know, read write mechanism, how you keep. If I want to, one guy wants to share that, the other guy should be keep it in a right manner. And the other one, it's a read or write manner. All the cores should be in the reading manner, and one guy only in the read manner or in the other way. So it is just, if we see that protocol, anyway, it's a part of assembly level code where we can see that the protocol, how it is defined. Yeah. With that, yes, I'm closing this. Thank you. If you have any questions, yes, you can close it. We have 1 more minute, we close exactly. Right? Thank you all.